concerns, but since we're ahead of time, we've got plenty of time if you're needing, we ask people to leave here at noon today. It's only 11:25. I don't want to keep you unnecessarily long, but if I can ask Sam and Gary, I don't want to take any last minute questions, any follow-up questions. Is any of the speakers who are still here and available today to answer any follow-up questions? Let's take about 10 minutes to ask and answer follow-up questions. Then I have a list of thank yous of people who contributed to the summit, and I want to leave with a couple of closing thoughts. So you guys want to come up? Sam and Eric, you want to come up? We'll take like 10 minutes of follow-up questions for any of the speakers that spoke earlier.
What is, if any, rules are there going to be with respect to fractionation? We start off with a 6U, but it may, could, in some instances, be advantageous to split that into 2 3Us after deployment. Is that a problem?
Yes, it is a problem. So, the secondary payload opportunity for EM1 requires that the 6U payload remain as a 6U. Because we have to levy anybody who's buying the opportunity on EM1, they must remain as a 6U unit. We have to levy that across the board to make sure everything happens. So your CubeSat must start as a 6U, remain as a full 6U. And I add the caveat that you may deploy solar panels, antennas, you may extend things from the original form factor, but you can't separate into like a 2U, a 1U, or 3U.
But you could have a situation where you have to maintain the overall 6U form factor, and you say you're allowed for deployment, but you can have deployable 1U elements that don't remain attached.
No. But, you know, I thought you were going with the fact that if you remain as a 6U, and say your concept is to take a mass and shoot it off with a long wire attached to it, as long as the 6U remains as a 6U, that's okay.
So, and that is and some
that,
physical
and
that
mass
is
attached.
Let's say any of these teams wants to procure a CubeSat class deep space transponder that JPL's already built. And last year they were trying to find a commercialization process to sell more, basically. If anybody in the next several months wants to investigate that option, is there a spec sheet for that transponder and will it be available in time to buy? Anybody know? I know Charles thinks it will be.
There are specifications. There are a couple of varieties of that radio that are currently in development right now. And unfortunately, Courtney could not be at this meeting. But if anyone takes a flyer from the table next to the JPL panel there, poster, you have email contacts of people you could talk to in all the areas that were discussed. I encourage people to do that. You did mention the RFI. I'm trying to get status on that. I believe that is still in development. So even though there is an interest in working with industry to produce these radios, it doesn't preclude anyone here that like that as a service to reach out to JPL or Courtney Duncan. That would be made available as a service to any team that desires that deep space transfer.
Two-part question. Are you allowed to expel propellant?
Are you allowed to expel propellant?
Yes.
Like as in making mass go out the back end and make it go forward?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, now what if my propellant is a tether and a 1 kilogram mass?
That remains tethered?
Well, no, you got to get rid of it to get the momentum.
No, you know, it's so propellant, how do we define propellant? Masses or ions or whatever, like your masses, the major masses need to be attached.
fundamentally, let's address the white elephant. You can't leave behind the relay station. Okay. We're looking for you to have your systems integrated into your single CubeSat that is flying to the moon, over the moon, beyond the moon, whatever. So, you know, can you have propellant? Absolutely. You know, how else are you going to get into orbit on the moon? Can you drop a relay station out the back end, drop a mass, and get to propel yourself forward? No. Can you drop something else to help benefit you and give you a competitive advantage over everybody else by leaving something behind and drop that mass for propulsion? No. Does that help?
Jettisoning a spent tank is a standard method of propulsion, right? So can I jettison spent, like deployment support electronics and that sort of thing?
Considering how a spent tank does nothing except become orbital debris.
Bypass ODOT. I mean, it would be on escape, so, you know, we'd go into heliocentric. Can I jettison?
Can you jettison debris? Can you jettison material that would not benefit you any longer or any further.
Yeah, build a two-stage propulsion system.
Yeah. I would say yes. Okay. And we'll document that. But again, it can't, obviously it's something you're jettisoning. You're not going to be using it any longer. It is not something that's a part of your system function. It's not only functional, it's no longer required, it's no longer needed.
There's a requirement in there for $1 million of liability insurance. I just wondered if, rather than everyone going out to different folks, if you have any estimate of about how much that insurance would cost.
So a lot of it kind of depends. If you're already a small business, you're already carrying your business liability insurance. Usually you just talk to your insurance provider, they'll be able to cover you under that. If you are a single individual or entity person, you're going to have to procure insurance. We've had that question quite a few times already.
Related to this, I'm notified our insurance company, they indicated that they could not provide a binder without additional information. I provided them all of the information from the website and my own narrative description thereof. This is an issue.
Yep.
I have previous declarations from other Space Act agreements where it was the scope of work was deemed as uninsurable because it had an intersection with the International Space Station. This one, of course, is more modest in those regards, but this is a real concern, and it may turn out that there is some appropriate clarification that will need to be provided.
So we've had discussions in regards to the duration and term for the liability insurance. From a programmatic standpoint, we have to make sure that what you're doing, say you're doing something, whether it's testing, procuring, machining, whatever, and the janitor comes walking by and gets injured or something from flying particles.
That's the general liability. That's really straightforward.
General liability. That is general liability. Once you go on the vehicle and you're in space, liability's gone.
That's where there's a problem with respect to the clarification of the documents. If it actually said that the expectation is a general liability, that is terms that the insurance providers understand.
I see your general business. And
so that clarification, let me just say, it saves all a great deal of grief.
Okay, and we'll continue.
We have somebody taking Q&A.
And I can provide a point of contact with all that.
So even sample return robot, robots are moving around.
Yeah, we'll talk later.
City car collecting up samples, they have to have liability insurance. So, you know, a lot of insurance companies will come to you and say, well, if you're doing a competition, you're going against each other, you're fighting each other. No, we don't show that. Well, no, we're not against each other. We're competing against each other, but we're not competing against each other. And so it takes some discussions, it takes conversation. We can be engaged in that to answer any relative questions of what is required, what's being a part of. But as Eric said, the liability part is to insure against personal liability. And I would say it's going to be required all the way up until you are well within orbit. Mm-hmm. So at that point in time, you don't have to worry about it falling down either, you know, or hurting somebody on earth. So, and you're basically ensuring that you're not going to, nobody's going to sue the government.
This allows about two or three more questions, and then I have closing comments.
I had the exact same question about the academic institution, because I'm from MIT, and I don't think MIT covers liability insurance for $1 million. So what are people typically planning to do?
So you have to check the university also, because we have seven universities competing in sample return robot, and they're all able to get their insurance. So we can speak with them in detail and figure out what they're doing. In fact, MIT is one of their competitors in June for the sample return robot, so obviously they do something within their university to get insurance. But that's a question I can pose to them to try to find out what they've done.
So there have been a variety of questions about relays and the allowability of that, and we've heard you can't jettison a part of an active part of your satellite off that as a relay, and there's a clarification yesterday that you can't use another existing satellite. As a relay station went up on a separate launch, I think. So I wanted to ask if there's going to be a rules clarification about that, and if the basic rule is anything that's above 100 kilometers above your searches, except your citizen, can be part of your system. Is that basically the rule?
The basic rule is no relay, no asset, no spaceport asset can be used as a relay. So we should clarify the rule. So we'll clarify the rules to make sure that's really explicit. Yeah.
Yeah, so I trust we're all in the mailing list and you'll be communicating with everybody here on a regular basis?
Yes, sir, absolutely. And that's part of what I'm going to be talking about that. Okay. That. Yes.
Thanks.
As well as, I guess Jim has, we have the intent of trying to create a forum.
Yeah.
So you can talk about that.
The LAGAN project has one, if not two, optical receivers set up. Are they going to continue to exist and might they be publicly available?
Gee, that's a good question. I don't know the answer. Can I get back to you on that?
That would be a wonderful thing.
Let's take two. Well, let's have, I'm sorry. One last question.
So you talked about mass ejection, debris ejection, or fractionation on Earth. Could you separate after you finish your competition? That's my first question. My second question is, how would you enforce the requirement that you cannot separate 6U into maybe 2-3U or whatnot?
Okay. So after the competition, it doesn't happen. It's your cube. If you're going to do science, you're going to gain an advantage. You're going to have to go for it. That's right. How are we going to enforce it? Well, again, we're talking about if you're separating and leaving a dead piece behind that you're not using. Okay. If you're separating and then using it as a relay, how are we going to enforce that at the public?
Because if you allow that. I mean, if you look at the design up front, you could tell whether there's a part that can be taken out. But if you allow them to separate after the competition is over, what is stopping the, I'm just playing devil's advocate.
No, someone will figure it out. I think it's contrary to the spirit of the rule, so we'll figure out a way to discourage them and make sure that. Is that right?
That's right. right, and I'm trying to, I just don't think, you're stuck with that one, it's a possibility, somebody could game us, but if they find out about it, you know, we're pulling money.
There's going to be some issues there. The ground permits are obviously demands that keep us privy and informed on the design. If it is segmentable, then yeah, there'll be a lot of questions as to.
You'll be grilled even harder.
Grilled harder.
So when are you going to segment, how are you going to segment, how you?
What's going to be in the different parts of your segments, you know, is there something that, is one that, do you have multiple telemetry systems within your segments? Yeah, it'll be grilled harder to, if you show that you're going to segment after this competition.
But I prefer to turn that question around the other way and say, secondary emissions, science payloads, something you want to carry for a commercial tech development, those would be ways for you to you know, demonstrate further capabilities outside of the challenge, that we're not concerned about what happens with your life, the life of your team set beyond the challenge.
And not only that, I had a question yesterday about teams that are low in resources. You know, this is a good chance to go seek out people that want space experience, want to send their experiments to space. You can collaborate with them and team with them. Idea. If you find that your telemetry system and navigation system only takes up 4 U, self-auxiliary moving to.
I'd like to, I wanted to wrap up and do the closing remarks, and then Sam and Eric and I will be around afterwards to answer additional questions. First, I'd like to thank all the people that contributed really countless hours to putting together this summit. I want to thank the Building 3 staff, including Anna Burton, Marco, and Felicia. I want to thank the registration staff from the Code R Mission Design Center, including Sarah Jolitz, Andrea Nizal, Catherine Bradford, Elizabeth Musbrook. I want to thank the aerospace engineering students from San Jose State University who staffed the poster sessions. Took notes during the talks, provided computer support, changing the slides, and staffed the Ames small satellite. And if I've left anybody out, I'm sorry, there were so many people that contributed to pulling together the summit. In addition to another great big thank you to all the speakers who gave us informative talks and shared their expertise with us in the last 2 days.
And by all means, email Jim. We'd like to hear what you like about it. More importantly, we'd like to hear what you didn't like about it. There's something we do. We do intend to try to have these.
So I guess,
either virtually or.
Do you have any other add-on follow-ups or any comments? Eric, do you have any add-ons or? So let me leave you with our next steps and food for thought. So here are the next steps. I want to thank you all for attending. We all hope that you received useful information today and you had a chance to compare notes with your fellow Q-Questers. Thanks for coming. We will post all the slides from the speaker presentations will be on the challenge website, so you can refer to them later. Also, we've acquired many questions that were of general interest to Q-Questers, and those are going to go into a frequently asked questions list. Hopefully with answers to that. And let's see. So we're considering further ways that we can enable dialogue, and we want to do that either virtually or in person in the future. So we've talked about, and we don't have the mechanics of this set up yet, but we'll either have a wiki or a Facebook page or something that allows teams to interact and to continue the dialogues that have started today, both not only for answering, asking questions of the Q-Quest administration, but primarily for the purpose of getting prospective team members a way of comparing notes and dialoguing and continuing networking. So stay tuned to the Q-Quest Challenge website and you'll see more about how we're going to set up this virtual collaboration space. I want to leave you with two thoughts. These are challenges, and these are my personal challenges to everybody in the room, including you, Sam, including you, Val. Challenges to everybody here that I want you to do tonight. What I want you, this sounds a little bit funny, but tonight when you go home or you're in your airplane or wherever you are at sunset, I want you to look up to the sky. This is the first approximately 45 minutes after sunset. First, watch the sun go down, because that's always good advice. Then, this is a conjunction of Venus and Mercury. Over the next several days, Venus and Mercury will be less than 1 degree apart in the western sky, just above the sunset, hands width above the horizon, so you have to have a clear view of the horizon. Wait for 45 minutes when it gets dark enough, and Venus will be obvious, but then just a thumb's distance from the lower right of Venus towards the sun, you'll see Mercury. Now, why is that a big deal? Well, Mercury is not visible to us very much of the time because it spends most of its time either in front of the sun or behind the sun in the daytime where we can't see it. But over the next few days, Mercury is going to be visible. And remember, the ancients talked about Mercury as being the fleet-footed messenger. So tonight, at sunset, watch the sunset, and then 45 minutes later, wherever you are, get a gander of Mercury, and think about getting your CubeSat 10 times farther than the Earth distance from us, and how it will be traveling into heliocentric space, into deep space, and transmitting messages. And when you look at Mercury tonight, think about what it will be like to operate your CubeSat in a heliocentric orbit, and what that means to you. The second thing is, I challenge you to do this again tonight. At about 8:45 tonight, you will see a waning gibbous moon rise above the eastern horizon. That was the other direction. So if you're in an airplane, you have to go into the, across the house. And think about what it's going to be like. Picture your CubeSat in orbit around the moon. And think about what it will be like to be one of the first CubeSat operators to operate your moon, your CubeSat there at the moon. So with that, NASA's going to, as you're looking up tonight at these astronomical objects, celestial objects, NASA's going to be looking to the citizen inventors, the members of this room, to develop the groundbreaking and game-changing technologies of the future that will help NASA to achieve future NASA goals and missions, to help develop an industry. So we're looking to all of you. So, as Pete Warden said yesterday, Godspeed, Cube Questers, and we hope you have a lot of fun with this challenge. So let's go to Cube Questers.